Good afternoon. Imagine a chemical that, if we couldn't produce it commercially, half of the world population today would not exist. Can you guess what it is? Well, I'll tell you. It is ammonia. This simple molecule, which is made up of three hydrogen atoms and one nitrogen atom, is actually how we make fertilizers and how we put nitrogen back in the soil to grow food. If we couldn't produce ammonia, we wouldn't be able to produce crops at the scales that we do now, and half of the world population would starve. So you probably figured that we'll be talking about chemistry today. My first memory about chemistry goes back to the times that I was growing up as a little girl in Turkey and a magazine cover that I saw. The cover showed a chemistry lab. It showed white cabinets, white countertops, white shelves, colorful chemicals, and a chemist, a woman chemist, wearing a white lab coat and running experiments. To be honest, I have never seen a chemistry lab that looked like that, but that image stayed with me, and perhaps it even played a small role in my choosing chemical engineering as my career. So my journey started in Turkey, where I was born and raised as the youngest of three daughters in a middle-income family. We didn't have a lot of material things, but there was a natural curiosity that my parents passed on to us, me and my sisters. And this natural curiosity, as well as the love of learning, took me all the way from Turkey to the United States, where I got my PhD in chemical engineering, specializing in catalysis. And then I ended up being the first female chemical engineering professor at Ohio State. Now, remember, we're talking about early to mid 80s, a time that, in some circles at least, engineering was still considered non-traditional for females. So probably my story as the first female chemical engineering professor at Ohio State can be the subject of another TED talk, but that's not what I'm going to talk about today. What I want to talk about is my research on heterogeneous catalysis and electrocatalysis, a field that uses chemistry very heavily, a field that I feel very passionate about, and also a field that I dedicated almost four decades of my life into. So maybe we should first talk about catalysis. What exactly is catalysis? What's a catalyst? A catalyst is a substance that accelerates a reaction rate without getting consumed itself in the reaction. And catalysis is a process where we use catalysts to accelerate the reaction rate. So let's illustrate this using a simple cartoon. So what looks like a rocky terrain here actually represents the solid surface of a catalyst, and we see a reaction site. And let's take a simple reaction, water and carbon monoxide reacting to give hydrogen and carbon dioxide. Now, in the catalytic cycle, water molecule and carbon monoxide molecule come and attach themselves on the surface. And then they get converted into products, in this case, hydrogen and carbon dioxide. And then they leave the crime scene, I mean, the reaction site. And what happens is this cycle repeats itself hundreds and thousands of times per second per site. So in a nutshell, this is what a catalytic process may look like. Actually, if we look at our everyday lives, we see examples of products that were produced using catalysis. For example, most likely the winter coats you're wearing or the shoes have materials in them that were produced using a catalyst. Gasoline was produced using a catalyst. Catalytic converters in our cars that eliminate air pollution or help with air pollution by eliminating the exhaust emissions. It's a catalytic process. From fertilizers to antifreeze, from paper to pharmaceuticals, from cosmetics to fuel cells to self-cleaning ovens even. These are all examples of how catalysis really impact our everyday lives. Okay, we talked about catalysis. What is electrocatalysis? Actually, it is a form of catalysis, but in this case, the electron transfer between the chemicals takes place through an electrical circuit. Let's illustrate that taking a simple reaction. In this case, we're looking at hydrogen reacting with oxygen, giving water. Hydrogen, in this case, is a fuel, and this is a combustion reaction. And whenever we have a combustion reaction, part of the energy inside the fuel is released as heat. And heat is good because the reason we're not freezing today is because there's a combustion reaction taking place somewhere. But each time we convert one form of energy into another form, part of it is lost to the surroundings. So in this case, if we're burning fuel and making heat, getting heat, we're losing part of the energy. If we go one step further, let's say that we want mechanical energy to drive the car, then we're even going further, and again, there is even bigger losses of energy to the surroundings. If we want to go all the way to electricity, and electricity is the most versatile, most valuable form of energy, the loss is even bigger. Wouldn't that be great if we could go directly from chemical energy to electricity? Well, the good news is we can do that. We can do that using a fuel cell. So a fuel cell, we'll come back to the hydrogen example. A fuel cell involves two half reactions. So in this case, we're going to consider this reaction as two half reactions. So on one hand, we have hydrogen molecules converted to hydrogen atoms with a positive charge, we call them protons, and releasing electrons. On the other side, we have oxygen and protons and electrons reacting to give us water. And we are separating these two reactions with a barrier, a physical barrier. We call it electrolyte. And this barrier doesn't allow the electrons to go through. It's not conductive, but it allows the protons to go through. Electrons, on the other hand, go through the external circuit and make electricity. That's how the light bulb came on. So a fuel cell, this is really the essence of a fuel cell. A fuel cell has two electrodes and electrolyte in between, and the surfaces of these two electrodes are covered by electrocatalysts. And that's what makes these reactions go forward. Let's take a look at another animation that represents a fuel cell. So we have hydrogen molecule coming and attaching themselves on one electrode, that's the anode, and then they get separated to protons, and they get transferred through the electrolyte to the other side, to the other electrode, and on the other electrode, they combine with oxygen, they form water, and then the water molecule leaves the surface, and this whole cycle is repeated over and over again. And in the process, we're making electricity. That's how the electric light bulb came on. Actually, we can reverse this process. Rather than making electricity, by providing electricity, we can split water into oxygen and hydrogen. In this case, a water molecule comes and attaches itself on the electrode, gets separated to protons and oxygen, and protons get transferred to the other electrode through the electrolyte, and they combine to give us a pure hydrogen stream. So we get a pure hydrogen stream and a pure oxygen stream on the two sides of the electrolytic cell in this case. So we can use catalysis, electrocatalysis, to make fuels in fuel cells, to make electricity or split water. But we can also use it to make important or valuable products, chemicals. Let's come back to the ammonia. So ammonia is produced through this reaction, nitrogen and hydrogen molecule giving us ammonia. But if you look at the process, it's a very old process. It was developed almost more than 100 years ago. Actually, it was developed during World War I in Germany. It is known as the Haber-Bosch process. It is a very large scale process. It requires pure hydrogen. Also, it requires very high pressures and very high temperatures. So it is 100% fossil fuel dependent, and the ammonia production in the world uses more than 2% of the world's energy supply. And to produce 1 kilogram of ammonia, we are emitting to the atmosphere between 2 and 3 kilograms of carbon dioxide, depending on where we get hydrogen from. If we get it from coal, it may be more than 3 kilograms of carbon dioxide per every kilogram of ammonia we're making. And the world is producing about 144 million tons of ammonia a year. So you do the math. If we want to sustain the world's growing population, but at the same time mitigate global warming, we really need to stop relying on such antiquated processes. We need to come up with new technologies, novel technologies that rely on renewable energy and introduce process efficiency. As I said before, electrocatalysis offers some solutions. We don't have to use electrocatalysis just to make electricity or split water, but we can use it for making chemicals. In this case, we are not providing protons or harvesting protons, but we are providing electrons. So let's take another look at this. And this is a scheme of the ammonia production through an electrocatalytic process. And this is a research area that my research group is working on, so it's very near and dear to my heart. So in this case, we're not using pure hydrogen. We're using only water. So the hydrogen is provided by the water molecule. It gets separated to protons and oxide ions. Oxide ions are transferred to the other electrode, give us a pure oxygen stream, and the protons react with nitrogen, giving us ammonia. There are many other examples where we can use electrocatalysis to produce useful chemicals. Again, another example from my research group is converting natural gas to ethylene. Now, we have an abundance of natural gas, but it doesn't have a lot of uses. We mostly use it as a fuel, we burn it. Ethylene, on the other hand, is a very important building block. We use it in many processes, such as producing polymers or polyesters or synthetic rubber. So this is a way of using electrocatalysis to make useful products. Another example is taking carbon dioxide directly from the atmosphere and converting it electrocatalytically, converting it to either a fuel or other value-added chemicals. So these are just a few examples from my research group where electrocatalysis can really make a difference and develop processes that will help humanity. Solutions to the world's most challenging problems really lie in science. And electrocatalysis is a branch of science that offers such solutions. If we can get young children excited about science, or if we can spark in them a natural curiosity, that's really a first step in the right direction. Just like the picture of a chemistry lab got me excited about science when I was a little girl growing up in Turkey. Although it doesn't look like the chemistry lab picture that I've seen when I was a young child, I want to leave you by showing you a picture of my lab. This is how it looks. And special thanks to Matt Fury, who prepared the slides for this presentation. Thank you.